is fate, for fate travels everywhere.
Charles Laughton Jr. has quite an extensive filmography. Of course, he's worked on over 100 films, worked for Columbia from 45 to 62, shot The Lady from Shanghai for Orson Welles, a film noir that makes use of long shadows and very dramatic, high contrast lighting. And of course, in The Lady from Shanghai, the famous sequence entering the mirror cabin, the maze with Rita Hayworth, that's Charles Laughton who created the visuals for that amazing sequence. He shot Two Road Together for John Ford. I mean, he was considered sort of the expert for exterior westerns, outdoor action sequences. In 2007, I was actually approached by James Mangold to redo 310 to Yuma. He had mentioned it to me a few years before, and so pretty much exactly 50 years after the original, we set out to New Mexico to do the remake. And of course, the first natural question is, how much do you want me to reference or to, you know, stylistically or pace-wise refer to and reference the original? And you know, to my surprise a little bit, James Mangold had said, you know what, don't even bother looking at it, which, you know, I proceeded not to, because I thought maybe there's a reason he didn't want me to really, you know, analyze it too much and be taken a direction perhaps that he didn't intend it. So, you know, of course I had seen the film probably a couple of times. You know, I'm sure I've seen it as a child growing up in Germany. You know, that's basically what I did. I would get to watch westerns on Saturday night on German television. We only had two channels, so three, but that was my main thing as a young man. Even before I was interested in cinema, I was always interested in Western. So obviously I remembered the film, and it was one of those Westerns that had left an impression. So so we proceeded to do the movie, and we started on the very elaborate sequence, opening sequence with the stagecoach, where the stagecoach is being held up by the gang. And of course, I didn't remember the details of how the original robbery was filmed. So it was quite a surprise, I must say, when we're about 2-3 weeks into the movie, and we just had completed this extremely complicated, elaborate robbery sequence in the beginning in Diablo Canyon. And it was very challenging and very limited, because we were in this canyon, in this riverbed, and we had all this equipment, and we had a Gatling gun, and we had, you know, it was a real action sequence, because we wanted the movie to start, obviously, you know, with a bang. And it just happened that one evening during the shooting, I turned on the TV and 310 to Yuma is on. So of course I watched it, but you know, I'd already shot the sequence. So one of the first, you know, strong comparisons and impressions when I watched the original, not as part of the preparation, but during the filming, was like, my thought was like, wow, how incredibly simple the shots were in a way, and economical, and how the sequence was covered in such a non-spectacular way, but how effective and how strong the characters were portrayed in it, despite despite its simplicity, or maybe because of its simplicity. And I was thinking, you know, we just did so much work, and here they are with this, you know, very efficient and very minimalistic sort of way of covering the scene, they were able to create equally as much tension and equally as much character and than we did. So that was, you know, sort of an interesting lesson to see, you know, that more is not always more, you know, less is sometimes more. And that really applies to the whole movie, because I viewing it, you know, recently again, and having completed our film and having watched our film, of course, several times, I think, you know, sort of a fundamental strengths of the film that we were able, I think, to create with Christian Bale and Russell Crowe, which is all about the tension and their interaction and how, in a way, the one person admires the other and they have this mutual respect. And, you know, the farmer has something about his life that the villain wants and respects, and is something he'll never be able to attain, and all those dynamics, we were able to capture, but you know how strong and how equally powerful they were captured in the original, and you know, also the cinematic devices, once the story progresses, are similar to the way we handle it. But I'm therefore I was happy that, you know, we were able to capture that spirit and live in that spirit without really leaning too much on copying the original, but the true essence and the value of the tension in those scenes are very similar. So I was happy to see that, you know, we were successful without really referencing the original too much. Obviously, you know, on 310 at the time, they were already in a color world, so it was a stylistic choice to do a Western in black and white. And the way the film begins, you have this very sort of long shot that slowly cranes up, and you just see it's already a very graphic shot that sets sort of the pace for the movie. And it's this sort of poetic crane shot that comes to the top, and then as the stagecoach approaches, it cranes back down. So it sort of sets a different kind of pace and indicates that, you know, we're in for a different tone of Western. And then the following cut is a very graphic a shot with very deep black shadows of the horses of the stagecoach against the dirt as it's moving across, and then it slowly tilts up to the horses. So already you're establishing a visual tone with the first two shots that are an indication of what is to come later, which is really, in a way, the use of shadows and graphic rich black tones that they've created. Makes it more sort of this intimate character drama. You know, it's less emphasis on you know, necessarily the landscapes. It's more about these characters that are going through this extreme conflict and tension. And it's almost, you know, like a film noir in a sense, because once we enter the dramatic scenes in the interior spaces, especially in the bridal suite in the end, I mean, there's very little fill light, you know, the people are very modeled and not really typical for the lighting at a time when you look at cowboys, for example, you know, of course, the color separation, but also, you know, just you just sense the amount of light, the huge arcs, you know, everything is filled in, and here there's a very, you know, sort of dramatic, stylistic approach that really supports the story. And of course, the choice of black and white, just like in the past or at the time or even today, you know, is something that creates drama in a different cinematic way. I mean, Orson Welles said black and white is the actor's best friend. There's something that, you know, allows you to take in a face and a performance in a different way without the distraction of a color palette, you know. And just like on Nebraska, obviously, when you have a close-up of Bruce Dern and his texture and his white hair, you know, it gives you a different connection to the character, and black and white in a way through its sort of minimalist graphic visual, allows you, I think, to tune into the character in a different way than visually splendid color version, technicolor version of a Western, you know. So it's a play. It's a real intimate play between these two main characters, and they really maintain that feel and were able to continue it throughout the film. I mean, they really stood out to me when they go under the overhangs on the sidewalks and very atypical for the time. I mean, they really let the characters go into complete silhouette. I mean, there was not a big concern for lighting them, and they really allowed people to maneuver in and out of a shadow, so you get this very sort of graphic figures moving, and that really stood out to me when I was rewatching it, just how dark they let things go at times. And even, you know, the saloon interior, we have a very similar shot in the remake, you know, where the whole gang lines up on the saloon, and it's still comparatively moody to other films of the period. I mean, it's kept dark and moody, and of course that is maintained through most of the interior scenes. Also the dinner scene when Ben Wade gets brought to Dan's house, and it was very similar. I mean, we of course, you know, in the more contemporary visual interpretation of it, created these moods, but I was astonished how progressive they were with creating those moods back in those days, where, like I said, you know, it was really not the standard approach to lighting. I mean, especially Westerns at the time. I mean, they certainly liked to have a broad hand with the arcs and really filling in faces. I mean, I think there was always a concern about, you know, how deep the shadows would be under hats and all that. So there was typically a lot of light being pumped into these films, but it's just really delicately handled, and also the use of shadows, apparently only shooting at hours where it allowed for long shadows on the ground, and constantly playing sort of with the graphic values of these rich black long shadows. Of course, you know, the dramatic climax of the movie takes place between noon and 3:10, of course, but regardless, you know, they took advantage of sort of the late hours of the day and apparently really chose to shoot in very specific times of the day in order to get those dramatic shadows and play with those graphic elements. This approach with the late dramatic light was also carried over to all the interiors. So when they enter the saloon, you get the long shadows of the figure entering on the ground, and of course, you know, in the climactic dramatic moments before the little journey to the train, in the bridal suite, again, the light is coming in from, you know, it's basically all the lighting sources are from outside the window, which is also not really, wasn't done at the time. I mean, especially these interiors, you know, they would really fill up the room, and it's all just directional hard light that's coming through the window as a natural source, but it creates a very dramatic, half light on faces and deep. The shadow side is very deep and very little information and very little fill, and that was really a stylistic choice that was, again, really not really applied to the genre at the time as much as, you know, it's certainly more a film noir approach, you know, which really seemed appropriate to this material, and creates a lot of tension that way. It was just interesting, again, to go back quickly to a comparison, you know, the sequences that we really expanded in 3:10 to Yuma, the remake with Mangold, in terms of action, of course, what was the opening sequence with Stagecoach hold up? But of course, we also dramatically extended, you know, the journey, the run to the train station. And again, looking at this, how economically it was handled, I mean, that was one of the surprises, because that was the other sequence we spent a lot, you know, there were a lot of people killed on the way, the whole town gets involved in the remake trying to shoot them, and, you know, so we created a little extra action there. But again, here, and rewatching the original, was like, the tension and the dramatic effect is just as strong, if not even more focused on the original, without all the, you know, additional coverage and sequences and shootouts. It's just really effective how it was told, and really economical, and it's a very well designed movie, and it really allows the audience to focus in on the emotions of our two main characters. You know. The son in the remake basically replaces the wife. I mean, he's the one who comes to contention. So that was a choice by the writer and the director to make that character the son, because he was really wanting the issue of the opening sequence where, you know, the son says, well, what are you going to do about it? You know, are you going to... And he says, well, there's not much, obviously, I can do.
Aren't you going to do something?
What, get myself shot too?
You know, it's 10, 12 of them, and they have guns. And that is played up a lot, sort of him trying to, you know, to prove to his son that he's worthy of completing this task that he was given, even if it means sacrificing and losing his life. So, you know, for that reason, we brought him to contention in the end so he could witness it. And also the key moment is, you know, when he gets shot and his son is right there with him. And he said, you know, I put him on the train, you know. So, I mean, that's very different in our film, yeah. But, you know, in the original, I mean, the wife has similar issues a little bit, you know, in the beginning. I mean, she's like, well, how could you not do something?
What's the matter?
Nothing. It seems terrible that something bad can happen, and all anybody can do is stand by and watch.
So, I mean, he's dealing, obviously, with this whole aspect of, you know, his manlyhood and his honor.
They have the boys watch.
All right, so that's life. You're going to have to watch a lot of terrible things.
The use of a close-up, when you use it at the right moments, of course, it becomes much more powerful. And if you overuse a close-up throughout a story, then it just becomes another shot. So to find those specific moments when you really go in and explore the details and, you know, the landscape of the face and let that dominate the frame. I mean, those become key moments and of course, are in this film.
What can I do? You're on the go and I'm stuck. I ain't complaining. I got something to remember.
You really want to be selective about when you choose to go in, and then of course it has a much stronger effect for the audience when you use that, and especially in connection with the dramatic lighting that is applied here, and they make great use of these extreme close-ups in those key moments, and they have a sequence in the bridal suite where it's one continuous slow push in. When he's tempting him to take the money, and he's Wade is trying to test him in a way, see at one point will he be corrupted, which, you know, he never accepts it, and which is something that of course Wade respects, but throughout that little testing moment we do a very, very slow push in and end up in a very extreme close-up, and we did that on the remake as well.
No, we're not even close.
Well, at about 3:05, Dan, we're going to be a lot closer than you think.
And on the reverse, on the reverse coverage on Christian Bale, we match that shot and we do one very, very slow physical dolly push in. And again, you know, you want to be You want to really pick your moments, and same on Nebraska. I mean, when we do go in on Bruce Dern's face, it's for very specific moments, and then that close up becomes much more powerful than if the audience is just being presented with close ups on everybody. It just loses its strength and its impact. You know, I mean, that's really with Alexander Payne. We always. Really pick our moments for the close-ups, and really not try to saturate the film with these close-ups. You know. And of course, it's interesting to see how you know, they handle the two westerns that 3:10 to Yuma, and then moving on only a year later on Cowboy. Just the stylistic contrast between those two pieces, of course, shows the strength of the mood piece that they created in 3:10 to Yuma, and you know, breaking sort of the conventions of the time by the way they approached 3:10 to Yuma. It becomes really clear when you see how the same team just moved on a year later to do Cowboy, and you know, really make use of color, use sort of the more traditional visuals at the time for westerns. The lighting is very different. There's a lot more light being pumped into the faces and the scenes. Although, you know, some of the night work on the cover was also, you know, you can see Charles Laughton Jr. still holding on to his delicate mood lighting and night lighting. I would say, although it's a more conventional visual approach to the Western, but there's some delicacy in the night scenes. The camp scenes on Cowboy were also nicely modeled and at the right level, and they didn't seem overlit. So you know, I guess the artistry of his finesse of his lighting carries on even on sort of the more you know, conventional approach to the Western at the period. And then as we're moving on to the 70s, of course, cinematographers started moving away from that traditional Hollywood lighting approach, because they would get more gutsy, let's say, take more chances and become more stylized. Even you know, I mean, as early as you know, the spaghetti westerns had a different approach, of course, and but of course, on 3:10 to Yuma, they were already really taking chances and really letting people, you know. Go into these shadows and go into these blacks. That was very atypical for the time. So that was in a way leading the way in terms of applying that visual language to that genre.
Oh, you've got no reason to go there, and there ain't a soul that you know there. When the 3:10 to Yuma whistles its sad refrain. Take that train.